Good morning, friends. Today we will discuss a very important topic, genetic algorithm. We all know that genetic algorithms are evolved on the basis of human evolution. They are the class of bio-inspired algorithms, very useful and having its application in all optimization problems. Today in this class, we will discuss the theoretical and practical concepts of genetic algorithms. Before going on the discussion for genetic algorithms, we have to see what artificial intelligence is. Well, AI is a branch of computer science and that is concerned with the automation of intelligent behavior. Intelligence is not very well defined and therefore has been less understood. Tasks associated with the intelligence, such as learning, intuition, creativity, and interference, all seems to have been partially understood. We know that capabilities of human being based on their intelligence is enormous, and we are not even in the vicinity when we talk of automating all these things. AI, in its quest to design intelligent systems, has fanned out to encompass a number of technologies in its fold. Of all these technologies, neural network, fuzzy logic, genetic algorithms are predominantly known as soft computing algorithms. What is soft computing and how it differs from hard computing? Well, soft computing is a consortium of methodologies that works synergistically and provides in one form or another flexible information processing capabilities for handling real life ambiguous situations. Its aim is to exploit the tolerance for imprecision, uncertainty, approximate reasoning, and partial truth in order to achieve tractability, that is nothing but polynomial complexity, robustness, and low cost solutions for real world problems. The guiding principles is to devise methods of computation that lead to an acceptable solution at low cost by seeking for an approximate solution to an imprecisely formulated problems. When we are talking of imprecise solutions, that means solutions which are acceptable to human beings. Soft computing technologies are various technologies like fuzzy sets. They provide a natural framework for the process in dealing with uncertainty. Another framework is neural networks, which are widely used for classification and rule generation based on domain knowledge. Then genetic algorithms, they are basically involved in various optimization and such processes. If we talk of genetic algorithms, GAs are a family of computational models inspired by genetic evolution. The basic idea is that each individual of an evolving population encodes a candidate solution, that is a prediction rule, to a given problem. GAs are adaptive, robust, efficient, and global search methods suitable situations where the search space is large. They optimize the fitness function corresponding to the preference criteria to arrive at an optimal solution using certain genetic operators. GA has been successfully applied to problems that are difficult to solve using conventional technologies, such as scheduling problems, traveling salesman problems, network routing problems, and financial market problems, and many more. If we look at the simple genetic algorithm, it is a very simple process. Initialize a population P of n elements, each as a potential solution, until a specified termination condition is satisfied based on the problem domain, based on the objective function. Use a fitness function to evaluate each element of the current population. If an element passes the fitness criteria, it remains in the next generation P. The population now contains m elements. Use genetic operator to create new elements add the new elements to the population. All this selection from the current population, which elements goes to the next population, it depends on the various genetic operators and various fitness criteria to be discussed next. Various advantages which this small steps encompasses with such a small algorithm is, first of all, easy to understand, general purpose, robust search techniques. Well, if they are general purpose, means they can be used for variety of problems. We always get an answer and it gets better with time. It's evolutionary process, means algorithm's output becomes better, better and better. They are inherently parallel and easily distributed. Genetic algorithm supports multiple objective objective optimization, which are normally hard to solve. They are good for noisy environment, they are modular, they are separate from applications. Simple, powerful and adaptive and parallel. They encompasses almost all capabilities. They guarantee near optimal solutions. Although we don't guarantee any solution for GA, but they guarantee a near optimal solution. They give solutions of an unapproximated form of problem. The finer granularity of search space, that means they search the whole problem space at a very fine granular level. Well, we talk of GA, the various components associated with the GA implementation, they are nothing but a problem to solve. Then we have encoding techniques, that is genes, chromosome. We have initialization procedure, how to initialize the initial population, how to create the population. We have evaluation function. These functions are based on the problems, the functions are based on the environment of the problem. Then we have the selection criteria of the parents. We have genetic operators like reproduction selections, mutation, recombinations. Then we have parameter settings, which is a very important aspect in all sorts of computing methods because they fluctuate depending on the parameter setting. Parameter setting, in fact, they depends on a particular problem. Representation of individuals. They are basically individuals of any population or genes. They are chromosomes. They can be any string like PQRST. We can use bit string. We can use arrays. We can use trees, lists, or any other objects. Any objects can define a population of genetic algorithms. Chromosomes represent a candidate solution. One chromosome encodes all the variables and they virtually represent a complete solution of any problem. Bit string representation, for example, could be of the form 1 0 0 1 1 0 1 0 on a binary input. Standard GAs normally use binary strings of fixed length, but many variants are available and can be easily modified for any finite requirements. For example, we can use 10 symbols 0 to 9. We can use alphanumeric. We can use letters and numbers simultaneously. Other type of encoding for parameters, we can use octal encoding, we can use hexadecimal encoding, we can use permutation encoding. For example, traveling salesman problem, where we have permutation of various cities, which can be used as a chromosome. We can use value encoding, we can use tree encoding even. So there are many type of encoding of parameters is available with GAs. For example, binary coded representations, let's say that we are trying to optimize the following function fx is defined as x square. For value of x from 2 to 1, it is greater than 1 and less than equal to 2 in the value range 1 to 2. If we were to use binary coded representation, we would first need to develop a mapping function from our genome representation, genome type representation, that is binary string, to our phenotype representation, that is actual mapping of the genome to the problem space. They phenotype representation, basically they represent the physical attributes of the system, values of the parameter. This can be done using the following mapping function. It's basically mapping is from upper bound minus lower bound, that is range. Then we have to have the decoded value of the chromosome divided by 2 raised to the power l minus 1 plus lower bound, where l is the number of bits representing a particular chromosome. This simple conversion from binary to decimal and then mapping it to the range of the value of a particular variable. This small decoding is there for mapping from phenotype representation to genome type. Genetic algorithms, if we take the value from upper bound is equal to 2, lower bound is 1, length of the chromosome in bits, L representing the length of the chromosome in bits, which basically define the precision level and the least significant factor in steps of a particular variable. In which particular range you want to vary the values of a particular variable. C, it is representing the chromosome. The parameter L determines the accuracy and resolution of our search space. What happens when L is increased or decreased? We know that if we increase the number of bits, the precision level, the resolution of our search space increases, because now we are separating the difference from 2 to 1. If we take 8 bits, then we are separating these in 256 different levels. If we are taking 7 values, we are representing in 128 different levels, so on and so forth. Two approaches to our representations are, first is either map to the binary representation, map the other representations to binary strings of fixed length and use standard binary string GS. And second one is modify operators. Well, if you want to use other kind of representations, the only possible base is that either use the binary representation, map your problem to the binary representation and use the standard binary genetic operators, or you use your own representation and change the genetic operators to meet those requirements. Well, fitness function, survival of the fittest. It is the whole aim of the fitness function. You know the genetic evolution, it lies on the basis of survival of the fittest. Numerically, figure of merit, utility of measure of an individual. It is trade-off amongst the multiple evolution criteria. It is efficient evolution. A fitness function should have capability to efficiently evaluate the chromosomes. Fitness function is often derived from objective functions, because we have to calculate the fitness based on our objective function. For example, for a maximizing problem, the fitness function will be proportional to fx, objective function, because you have to maximize the objective function. So chromosomes with the higher fitness value should give a value which is larger. For minimization problem, it should be inverse of the objective function. If you want to minimize the objective function, then fitness function should give lower values for better chromosomes. So it should be an inverse relationship. If the function is 0, this could be defined as 1 upon 1 plus fx to avoid the mathematical problems. Creating a new generation of offsprings, we have a two-step process. Well, we have generation T, consists of solution T1, solution 1, solution 2, solution 3 and solution N. It is all the chromosomes defining the various solutions in time t. We select some chromosomes based on the fitness from the current population. and then we create solution 1, solution 2, solution 2 and solution 4. As given in the figure, it is shown in the figure that solution 1 is replicated in the selection process, while the solution 2, they have its two office things, its representation in the next generation, the selection is 2-4, it is twice, because this solution 2 is more fit. We have again the replication of selection solution 4. This way, by applying certain selection criteria, we select chromosomes from the current population to be a candidate to go for the next population, next generation. Then we apply recombination operators, crossover, mutation to generate offsprings of the current selected populations to find out the next population. This is the whole process, whole philosophy of genetic algorithms. Various selection operators is fitness proportional to, first one is fitness proportionate selection. They are the Fi divided by F. They proportionately based on the fitness of a particular chromosome, we replicate its instances in the next population. Number of reproductive trials for individuals. We have a grounded field selection for its implementation. The read space is proportional to fitness values. In this grounded field, each chromosome has its own proportion. And we have a pop size and spins of the field. We have a pointer, and for selecting n different chromosomes in the second population, we rotate the wheel for n times. Every time pointer pointed to a particular area represented by a chromosome, that particular chromosome is replicated in the next generation. This space in the wheel is provided, it is proportional to the fitness of the current chromosomes. Well, grounded wheel selection, how it is implemented actually? Implementation wise, use the following steps. Calculate S, the sum of the fitness, generate a random number between 0 to S, where S indicating the fitness of all chromosomes of the current population. Starting from the top of the population, keep adding the fitness to the partial sum P till P is less than S. Based on the random number, the individual for which P exceeds S is the chosen individual. This is how we can implement the random, the grounded wheel implementation. And the selection procedure is two-number selection. In this selection, list all individuals with fitness values, select any two individuals at random, take the one with higher fitness value and promote it to the next level. It is very simple. Repeat the same for selecting full size of the population. And the selection criteria is stochastic universal sampling. In this, n equally spaced pins on the wheel, we rotate the wheel once. Based on the proportionate area of a particular chromosome, particular element of the population from the current population, if more than one pins indicate to a particular region, that particular chromosome is pasted, is promoted twice in the next population. Then we have rank selection. A rounded wheel has a problem when the fitness value of the individual offers differs very much. If best chromosomes have fitness greater than 90%, then 90% wheel will be occupied by the chromosome. So other chromosomes has less chance to occupy space on the wheel. In rank selection, all chromosomes are assigned ranks irrespective of their fitness values. If there are 5 chromosomes, then they will be having proportionately 1 by 15, 2 by 15, 3 by 15, 4 by 15 and 5 by 15 of the wheel. We have 15 indicating the sum of all 5 ranks. Then we have crossover operator. We have single point crossover, multi-point crossover and various other variants. If we see, pairing 1 and pairing 2 and the crossover site indicated by vertical line, then after this operator is applied, office pins which are generated, they are, the portion is interchanged. The portion after the crossover site is interchanged to generate the office pins for the current pairings. This is single point crossover. Basically, it is used to combine good building blocks. If two best fit solutions are, they are crossed over, then there are larger possibility that we can have goodness of both the parents in a single child, and thus the population progresses towards betterment. Then we have uniform crossover. Then we have crossover sites, many crossover sites, which are, after applying these operators, individual bits are interchanged in the office space. We have range crossover, we have other crossover operators, multi-point crossover, where a particular subset of current pairing is interchanged. This is the graphical representation of crossover. Suppose X points representing the two pairings in the graph, and office springs are presented by dots. So we can see that pairings, they are not better fit, but the office springs generated by two pairings, their fitness value is much larger than their pairings. So there are equal probabilities that pairings with office springs generated from a fit pairings, they give you better probability of being fittest. Then we have mutation operator, which with a very small probability, which alters each gene with a small probability. Mutation operators are applied to avoid local minimas and to give your search space a diversity of search, so that you can even sometimes mutate in some of the bits of the chromosome and preserving the probability to search other small details also. Why crossover in mutation? Well, crossover produces new solutions while remembering the characteristics of old solutions. Partially preserves distribution of strings across the schemas. Mutation, it randomly generates new solutions which cannot be produced from existing population. They avoid local minimas. So both kind of crossover and mutations are required to generate a new population which is better than the current. Genetic algorithm example. The simple genetic algorithm, for our example, we use a population size of 6, a crossover usage rate of 1.0, and mutation rate of 1/7. These are the various parameter settings which we have assumed for a sample run. Let's try to solve the following problem. Function fx is equal to x square, where x varies from -2 to +2. Let I is equal to 7. That means our mapping function, our bit string chromosome will have 7 bits to represent a particular chromosome. Our mapping function will be defined as 4, that is upper bound minus lower bound, 4 multiplied by decoding of a particular chromosome divided by 127 minus 2. Because 127 is nothing but 2 raised to the power 7 different labels. And lower bound is substituted to fit the range of the particular function, particular variable. Genetic algorithm, if we assume randomly generate an initial population, person 1, we are generating these population randomly, person 1 to person 6, 100, 1010, we have 7 bits as assumed. We have person 2, 01, 00101, 11010110, 011, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, 0110, 100, 11, Then we have phenotype representation, that is these particular genotypes, they are mapped to the physical attributes, the values associated with them. Then what about fitness? Well, we evaluate the population at time t is equal to 0, and if we calculate the fitness, which is nothing but the function fx itself, we have, because we have to optimize, maximize the function, so we are considering the fitness function proportional to fx. If we take that fitness value, the fitness value of various persons coming out to be, first person is 0.109, second two it is 0.697, that is 1.790. Then we have fitness of person 4 as 0.090. We have person 5, 0.238, person 6, 2.531. We have various fitness values for the current population. Then we have select 6 parents using their order mean to generate next population. We have to select the various 6 new population, all the 6 parents based on the Rowland V fitness. For that, we have arranged based on their fitness, and the first one is based on the Rowland V, the population which is generated is person 6 having the highest fitness 2.531. it is having the first appearance. Then we have person 3, then again if we Rowland V is reward, then we have again person 5, fitness value 0.238, again we have person 6. Now see, because the person 6 is having the highest fitness, so it is having 2 instances in the next population. Then we have 1 instances from person 5, 3, 2 and 1 based on their fitness value. As the person 6 is having the more than double the fitness, very high fitness, its instances is twice in the next population. Then we have create offsprings of 1 and 2 using single point crossover. Now we are proceeding to apply the various genetic operators to generate the next population. We take person 6 and person 3 and we apply a single point crossover indicated by a vertical lines. The child 1 which is generated is 00, 01, 010, 0, and child 2 is 11, 0, 11, 0. The phenotype value associated with these 2 children is defined as -1.685 and 1.433. Well, fitness value of the again we apply single point crossover to create offsprings 3 and 4 on person 5 and person 6. We are taking them in sequence. We apply at the fourth place. So after applying these, the offsprings are generated, which are child 3, 10, 1, 11, 00. Then we have 000, 10, 11. Well, here the mutation comes into the picture. We apply the mutation operator on the selected bits indicated in red in child 3 and child 4. We apply mutation operator by using a random number, and we happen to be applied on this child 3 and child 4, and bits which are indicated in red, they are mutated. Like while generating the child 3, it was basically 1001101. But now after application of mutation, the last bit of child 3 is muted from 1 to 0, and the third bit is complemented from 0 to 1. Again we apply mutation operator in child 4. All these operators are being applied on a random basis. again creating office prints for 5 and 6, taking another pair of the remaining chromosomes, and person 2 and 1. Again we apply a single point crossover, and the child's generated are 11010101010101. Again, bits indicated in red, they are just indicating that mutation operator has also been applied on these particular bits, so making them 0 to 1 and 1 to 0. Now, evaluate the office bits. The next operation which is generated, you see the child 1 which is generated is 0001010. It is 0001010. In the similar way, all these 6 childs which are generated, they are kept as a nest population, and now we apply the fitness function to calculate the fitness. If you look at the fitness of various chromosomes, various childs which are generated, you see that fitness value of average child has been increased from the previous generation. In the last generation, only one chromosome was there with fitness more than 2. But here we have 3 chromosomes with fitness value 2.8, 2.0 and 2.7. One chromosome with a fitness value of 1.7, indicating that our next generation is better than the previous one. Now the same process will be applied to again and again. As a comparison, after sample 1, population at t is equal to 0 is indicated, and population at t is equal to 1 is indicated, and it is clearly visible that next population, next generation is having better fitness than the previous one. Population at t is equal to 1 is indicated and with their fitness here in this slide. The process of selecting 6 parents, allowing the parents to create 6 offsprings, mutating the 6 offsprings, evaluating the offsprings, and replacing the parents with the offsprings is repeated until a stopping criterion has been reached. Well, the stopping criterion is either the number of runs of GA or the average fitness of the population. Any termination condition will be decided based on the problem domain. Convergence of DA, convergence of genetic algorithms, is basically its progression towards uniformity in population. In all chromosomes of a particular population, they achieve the similar level of fitness, that means we have reached to a saturation and our algorithm terminates, since we don't have any chances of improvement. Either there is a premature convergence also, sometimes it is called the local optima, where you have all the chromosomes which are better, but we have still chances to improve. Such things are basically improved upon by using mutation operators, but still there are chances for some of the algorithm to end up in the local optima. This is a premature convergence. We converge in the local optima. Well, the parallel search of genetic algorithm can be better viewed in this diagram, in this graph, where the chromosomes are mapped, plotted against their fitness values. We see there are many local minimas, there are many maximas, and the population indicated by dots, they are distributed in whole problem space. GS, being a parallel search algorithms, they basically attack the problems from all sorts, all positions, and there are fair chances that any one of the chromosome which is available distributed in the whole problem space reaches to a global maxima. This graph indicates the whole search process, how the various chromosomes searches and try to reach to the global maxima. A typical run of GA is, it's a best run when it is trying to reach the first dotted curve, indicates the best run of GA, where It is very rapidly converts to the final value, and finally, after reaching to the mature solution, final value, when all the chromosomes have the equal highest fitness value, they saturate, and then the further improvement in the fitness is rarely possible. At average level of GA, where it reaches to the final value slowly, and it takes larger iterations to reach to the final value. How GA works? Let us see some theoretical concepts of genetic algorithms. How they work? Well, we have a population. It is defined as a string of alphabet 0 and 1 of length L. That is, a string is represented as 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. We are looking at the theoretical foundation of genetic algorithms. How all these simple algorithmic steps, how they solve so many complicated problems. We have to define a schema. A schema is a subset of the space of all possible individuals for which all the genes matches the template for a schema. H. It is indicated by H. That is a subset of strings with similarities at certain string positions. String over alphabet 0 and 1 of length L. For example, schema H is indicated as 1 star, 1, 0. Now, 2 star positions, they will be replaced by all possible combinations of 0 and 1. So, subset of strings which is represented by this schema H is nothing but 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. 1 and 1, 0 at end, they remain constant. And the 2 star positions are replaced by all possible combinations of bits. Then we have a concept of hyperplane model. Well, such a space, it's a hypercube with n dimensional space. For example, indicating a 3 dimensional such space. Individuals, they indicate chromosomes, solutions, they indicate the vertices of hypercube. Schemas are nothing but they are hyperplanes formed by set of vertices. In blue, we are looking at schema 0 star star because all 4 vertices which are representing this particular schema, they have 0 in common. Then 2 star positions, that is represented by 0 0 0, 0 0 1, 0 1 0 and 0 1 1. So we have 0 in common and 2 combinations of 2 bits representing a plane which is nothing but a schema. Sampling hyperplanes. Look for hyperplanes, schemas with good fitness values instead of vertices to reduce such space. Basically, hyperplane indicating a set of vertices virtually, set of solutions. So, genetic algorithm looks for sampling better hyperplanes with good fitness values. Every schema matches with exactly 2 rest to our R strings, where R is the number of don't care symbols. Simple. Every schema matches with exactly 2 rest to our all strings. In the previous example, we saw that schema 0 star star, we have don't care positions 2 in number, so it is matching with 4 vertices 0 0 0, 0 0 1, 0 1 0 and 0 1 1. Likewise, for a schema with don't care positions 3, we have 8 exact vertices indicated by that particular schema. There are some theoretical things. Every vertex of a hypercube is a member of 2 rest to the n minus 1 different hyperplanes. Well, every vertex is indicated by 3 bits. Every vertex is indicated by 3 bits. So it is, if it is a 3 bit number, that means 7 different hyperplanes is represented by each vertex. You can see it is clearly visible from this cube. We have 3 adjacent faces. Simultaneously, we have 3 different ages which are emerging from, let us take the example of 000. So we have three different faces for indicating three different schemas. We have three different lines, ages emerging from 000, and finally one schema represented by 000 itself. So indicating seven different schemas which are represented by a particular vertex and exactly 2^n-1 different hyperplanes. Entire such space defines 3^n possible hyperplanes. We can justify from the previous figure that 3^L, in this case, it is 27 minus 1, I think. 27 different planes which are indicated by this particular cube. Then we have average fitness of the hyperplane can be estimated by sampling fitness of members in its population. If a particular hyperplane having four different members, so the fitness of all members actually gives an estimation of fitness of a particular plane. Selection retains hyperplanes with good estimated fitness value and discard others. This is the whole theory of genetic algorithms. We have schema theory. We have to define certain theoretical values, schema order OH. Basically, it is the number of non-star genes in a particular schema H. For example, order of one star is 2. It is order is 2 because only 2 elements are non-star, non-dual pair. Therefore, schema H will represent 2^L minus OH individuals, because we see L is 5 and non-star positions is 2. So basically we have 3 don't care conditions. So we have seen earlier that schema will exactly represent 2^3 different individuals. It is proved from here. Schema defining length delta H, it is nothing but schema defining length is the distance between the first and the last non-star gene in schema H. For example, delta 1 star star 1 star, it is 4 minus 1 is equal to 3. 4 is the position of second one and 1 is the position of first one. So it is 4 minus 1. Basically, it is the distance between two non-zero non-star elements. Then we have schemas with shortest defining length, low order, with fitness above average population are favored by GAs. Schemas with short defining length, low order, with fitness above average, they are actually preserved by the GAs and favored by them. We have schema theory, terminology continue. Let's MHT denote the number of instances of H that are in the population at time t. The particular instances of a particular schema H at time t is indicated by MHT. Let FHT denotes the average fitness of the instances of H that are in the population at time t. Well, MHT is the number of instances and FHT is the average fitness of those instances at particular time t. We have to prove that MHT plus 1 is better than MHT. FHT. Let FMHT represents the average fitness of the population at time t. Let BC and PN represent the single point crossover and mutation rates. According to schema theorem, which is a very popular theorem for genetic algorithms, there will be MHT plus 1 is equal to MHT FHT upon FMHT instances of H in the next population if H has an above average fitness. This equation gives you the indication that if the average fitness of a particular schema is more than average, then proportionately those schemas will be forwarded to the next population from the current population. According to the schema theorem, there will be m h t plus 1 instances at time t plus 1 is equal to the m h t instances at time t in proportion with the fitness of a particular average fitness of a particular schema as compared with the average fitness. Instances of h in the next population, if h has above average fitness, is given by the schema theorem. If we let f h t is equal to f average t plus c, where c is equal to 0, greater than 0, c f average t for some c greater than 0, then we have m h t plus 1 is equal to m h t upon 1 plus c, not m h t multiplied by 1 plus c, because it is, if we replace this f h t, a f average t plus some more than average, if we define that the average fitness of a schema slightly more than the average fitness, then this equality holds, and we prove that m h t plus 1 at next instance, the number of chromosomes in the next level t plus 1 will be m h t multiplied by 1 plus c, and as c is greater than 0, it is going to be more than m h t. If m h 0 is greater than 0, then we can rewrite the equation as m h t is equal to m h 0 1 plus t raised to the power t. This is what this says, is that proportionate selection allocates an exponentially increasing number of traits to above average schemas. Some formal statements about genetic algorithms. We cannot go into the detail of all these expressions this time. So, just I have briefed some of the formal statements, like selection probability E, MHT plus 1 is MHT, FHT upon F, where F bar indicating the average probability, average fitness of the schema, average fitness of the population. Crossover probability, PH crossover is equal to PC, P is the probability of crossover, delta H upon L minus 1. Mutation probability, P X mutation is defined as O X P M. Expected number of members of a schema is given by this popular expression. Expected number of members of a schema at time t plus 1 is derived from the numbers at time t. They are M H T, F H T upon F average, 1 minus PC delta H upon M minus 1 minus PM OH. This defines, clearly indicates that expected number of members of the schema is increasing and better fit solutions will certainly reach to the next level. Well, after this theoretical background, any algorithm is not useful until and unless it has applications. GAs. We are fortunate to have GA, which has enormous applications in almost all domains. They can be used for non-analytical problems, but they can be used for non-linear models, they can be used in uncertainty, they can be used in large state spaces. Non-analytical problems, their fitness functions may not be expressed analytically on this. So, in such situations, we can have subjectively defined fitness functions, and we can use genetic algorithms. Domain specific knowledge may not be computable from fitness function. In such situations also, we can use genetic algorithms. Scarce domain knowledge to guide research. We don't have enough knowledge to guide our research. Even we can use genetic algorithms. In non-linear models, solution depends on starting values. Non-linear models, we don't have any linear equation to define the values, exact state space of a particular problem domain, but GA is the solution. We can start if the solution depends on the starting values. those kind of problems can be solved by GAs. Non-linear models may converge to local optima. This is a certain problem associated with GA, but of course they can be used. Normal situation, non-linear systems can converge to a local optima, but by using GAs and using various GA theoretic operators, their chances are fairly less, and normally they give better solutions. They impose conditions on fitness function such as convexity, etc. In such situations, we can also use theoretic algorithms. Uncertainty, noisy, approximate fitness functions, changing parameters, changing fitness functions, they can be used everywhere. Large state space, heuristic focus is only on the immediate area of initial solution. State explosion problems, number of states, enormous huge number of states, or even infinite, too large to be handled. In all such situations, GAs give yes to the better solutions. State space may not be completely understood. In such situations also, a GA provides you a simple solution. Application examples are function optimizations. They are difficult, discontinuous, multimodal, noisy functions. All sort of functions can be optimized by using theoretic algorithms. We have combinatorial optimizations, like for example, layout of VLSI circuits, factory scheduling, traveling salesman problems, etc. We have design and control, bridge structures, neural networks, communication networks, control of chemical plants, pipelines, etc. We have machine learning, classification rules, economic modeling, scheduling strategies, etc. Portfolio design, optimized trading models, direct marketing models, sequencing of TV advertisements, adaptive agents, data mining, etc. We can use generic algorithms. Well, they are not always used. Why not to use GAs? When constrained mathematical optimization problems, especially when there are few solutions. When GA optimized, GA provides you a solution when there are large number of solutions exist. So in problems, there are especially very less solution, so GA will take large time to reach to that particular solution. Constraints are difficult to incorporate with GA. The problems are so constrained that the various constraints are difficult to incorporate in objective function and fitness functions, then of course GA is not usable. When guided domain search is possible and efficient, if we have some analytical method to search a particular problem space, then of course GAs are not the better solutions, because they provide you approximate solution, but they provide solution to almost all problems. But you have analytical solutions, then GAs are not the good candidate. Well, thanks friends, this is all for today. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the other soft computing methods. Thank you.